Perfect. Well, thank you very much. Thanks for having me. So this is joint work with Vikram Maheshri, who's right there. So this is a paper on Duverger's law. So at the national level, so on the number of parties that compete at the national stage under different electoral systems. And so I guess our first remark is that so Duverger's law, which says that there should be two-party competition under a plurality rule, and sort of what people call the Duverger's hypothesis, which says that more proportional systems should favor more parties. So these are predictions that are made in static models, static theoretical models. And the way that, you know, sort of traditionally people have looked for evidence is to collect, say, cross-country data on the number of parties competing in various elections, and then just check if it's true that under, say, plurality systems, you tend to get more two-party competition. Now, you know, one remark that's not new to us, but is that, you know, if you look at a particular country, that country rarely will change its electoral system, but its party system, or in particular the number of parties that compete in elections, that changes quite a bit. So there's frequent entry of new parties and exit of existing parties. Now, that shouldn't be surprising, because even though that country's electoral system doesn't change, everything else about its political system can, right? So voters' preferences, the issues that are important, the corruption, I mean, some politicians' characteristics and so on, these things change. So you should expect opportunities for new parties to emerge, and you should also expect old parties to sometimes choose to either merge with competitors or to disappear or to disband. So what that to us leaves as a question is, you know, can it be that different electoral rules will yield different party system dynamics? And in particular, what we're going to be interested in is, could it be that different electoral rules lead to systematically different changes in the number of parties over time? So that's the main question of the paper. And so there's two things that we do. So the first thing we do is we want to write down a very simple dynamic model where the key thing is that it allows for parties to form and to disband over time. Now I'll get into details, but sort of, you know, one thing that the model will not provide is a prediction on whether or not there should be more or less parties under plurality or under proportional. So I'll be more specific, but there'll be equilibria under proportional representation, in which you can at a particular point in time have less parties than you would have under some equilibria and under plurality rule. What it will suggest is that we can expect plurality rule to generate it may not generate less parties, it will generate less variability in the number of parties over time, right? So we're gonna, that'll be sort of coming out of the model. And this, in principle, this is a stylized fact that we can then go check. This is, you know, we thought that maybe somebody had checked this. We couldn't find anywhere where this had been done. And so essentially what we'll do in the second part of the paper is a very simple empirical exercise where we look at a sort of a common data set of electoral results and then construct a measure of party entry and exit, and then look at common measures of electoral systems and then try to get a sense of how robust the correlation is between variability in the number of parties and the electoral system. So that's the basic game plan. So before I get into details, I just want to give an idea of what the main mechanism we have in mind in the model. So the key aspect of the model is the political environment is going to change over time. So there's going to be some party that, say, at a given time finds itself with poor electoral fortunes, right? So this party is not expected to be a competitive party in the current election. And at the same time, running in elections is costly, or at least the benefits it can expect from running are low, right? But the political environment is changing, so it can expect that in the future it might again find favor, say, with voters, or be expected to be a competitor. So the main decision in the model is going to be the decision of supporters, of those people that are maintaining a currently unpopular party, they're going to face a decision between disbanding this party and, say, merging it with the closest alternative party, or with the possibility of possibly reforming a party that has a similar ideological slant, say, in the future. But there's going to be it's going to be more costly to start a new party than to maintain an existing party. So having a party that represents your views in the system is going to generate an option value. So the key thing, so in case I get lost in details, the key thing that we want to think about is how the electoral system affects this option value of having a party that represents your views. Right. So we normally think of plurality rule as imposing sort of higher static or stage costs to currently unpopular parties because these plurality systems will tend to underrepresent, say, in parliament parties that have a smaller vote share, right? So that should drive more parties to want to leave under plurality rule because being a less competitive party and running elections gives you less benefits in terms of influence on policy and other things. Now, if you think about these supporters of a party that's currently doing poorly, if you think about their decision if you think about how they're forecasting the possibility to re-enter with a new party in the future, well, there's also higher barriers to entry under plurality, so it's harder for new parties to break through in terms of, say, getting voters to coordinate onto them as opposed to well-established parties and so on. And so these higher sort of forecasted barriers to entry in the future are also going to act as barriers to exit today, right? So you might then expect that plurality generates maybe more incentives to leave, but also more incentives to stay. And so what you can expect is that there might be less entry by new parties, but also conditional on participating, less exit by established parties. So I certainly won't have time to do justice to the literature, so maybe I'll say two things. So one is that a lot of the literature, a lot of the theoretical literature thinking about the number of parties, or at least thinking about Duverger's law is really at the district level, because this is where you can really think about voters' coordination problems and the impact of strategic voting. And we also know that it can be difficult to aggregate these incentives at the district level to the national level. This is what Gary Cox called the linkage problem of linking the incentives for strategic voting at the local level to the aggregate level. Now, so we're aware of this, so I guess we're going to abstract from this. So I guess one way to think about what we're doing is we're going to abstract away from how sort of local incentives get translated to the national stage. We're going to think first of the national stage, but what we're going to provide is a reason why you wouldn't necessarily expect that there be more parties under proportional than plurality based only on dynamic incentives and not on how these incentives at the local level might be mapped to higher. Maybe another note is there's not, at least to our knowledge, a lot of work looking at the comparative dynamics of say party participation under different electoral systems. There's one recent paper I'd like to highlight by Anagata and Fujiwara, because we'll use some of their results as we can use some of their results as motivation for some of our assumptions in the model. And they study what they call the runner-up effect, which is they look at sort of close second candidates in plurality elections and find that they have better outcomes in the future, so a higher likelihood of running again, and in some cases a higher likelihood of winning elections than close third candidates. And so they interpret this as coming in as a second-ranked candidate in a previous election acts as a sort of a natural coordinating device for voters in future elections. And this idea that past electoral outcomes can have an impact on coordination in plurality elections in current elections is something we're going to use. Okay, so let me explain the model. So again, the model is going to be very simple. So there's elections held at each period over an infinite horizon. So the party that wins the election at a given time is going to implement one of three policies, so x minus 1, x0, x1. So you can think about this as left, center, right. So the parties themselves can be of the three types, minus 1, 0, 1. Now, we're going to think about parties just as vehicles for implementing the policies that bear their label, right? So the parties can't commit to policies, but if you've got a party of type J in power, then he implements just policy XJ. We're going to assume that the middle party, party of type 0, is always present. So then the parties that may or may not be present are the two extreme parties, minus 1 and 1, right? And now the players in this game are going to be interest groups that can support, if they choose, parties of type minus 1 and 1. And so they're going to choose each period whether or not they want to start a new party of this type or whether or not they want to maintain an existing party. So, you know, this is very simple, but you can have at any one time one, two, or three parties. Right? One party if only the centrist party is in, two parties if you've got the centrist along with one of the extremes, and so on. Okay, so we're going to model reduced forms, model elections in a very reduced form way. So again, what's going to matter, what we wanted to have in this model is a political environment that changes over time. So we're going to model this by what we call a preference state. So you can have a preference state S1, S0, S minus 1. And this is basically, if the preference state is S1, that's just going to tell us as the policy position X1 is the policy position that the voters like the most, right? So then the support of policy 1 is this P upper bar, which is higher than P, which is higher than P lower bar, right? If the these preference states, just to make our lives easier, are IID, and we're going to treat the two extreme parties symmetrically. So with probability Q, you have the preference state being the middle state, and with the complementary probability split over two, it's one of the two extreme states. So, so if the preference state is in the middle, then the middle policy receives P upper bar in terms of policy support, and the other two share what's left, and so on. So now, a party will collect the support of the policy it shares a label with only if that party is active in a current election, right? So we'll just introduce a little bit more notation. So a party structure at T is just lists those parties that are active at T, right? So then if, say, all three parties are active at T, then the party support of party one is just going to be the support from that policy. Now, if one of the two extreme parties is not present in the current election, say if only these two parties are participating, well, then we just assume that the policy support from the party that is not active is just transferred to the centrist party. None of these, you know, exactly how we transfer the support around when some parties are not active is not particularly important. We just chose this specification. Okay, the same thing happens in other cases. Okay, so now we want to model elections. In particular, we want to have a sort of a simple way to classify proportional representation versus plurality. And so what we're going to do is just basically take a probabilistic voting approach where we're going to map the party supports into probabilities of winning for each parties. And then that's going to tell us what the policy outcome just by the fact that parties implement policies that share their label. And so what we're going to do is represent plurality rule and proportional representation by two different mappings from party supports into electoral outcomes. Now, proportional representation is going to be simple. So we're just going to think about a party's winning probability is proportional to its support. And so, you know, if whatever parties are competing in the current election, their probabilities of winning is just exactly equal to their share of support. So now we're going to think about plurality rule as differing from proportional representation by by essentially just two parameters. So, and we're gonna, so let me, I'll first explain exactly what the assumption is, and then I'll give you a sense of why, of how we justify them after. So first, let's think about the preference state favoring party one, or policy one. And let's think that, and let's imagine that all three parties are active in the current election. So under plurality rule, this is where you'd have a coordination problem for voters, because there are three parties in the election. Now, party minus one is the minority party, so it's not favored by the preference state, and so we're going to assume that its probability of winning the election is the support for its policy position minus this parameter alpha, which is a penalty, which we call the minority penalty, right? So, and we just transfer this probability of winning to the majority party S1, right? So what this penalty alpha reflects is the standard cost to strategic voting against parties that are not expected to be competitive. That's in both the theoretical and the empirical literature. Right, so these are the main static reasons why the static costs imposed on small parties under plurality. Now, note that this penalty is only imposed when there are three parties in the running at a particular election, right? So this is really a reduced form coordination cost imposed on the small party. Now, the other way in which we're going to think about plurality as differing from proportional is with respect to the costs imposed on new entrants, or the disadvantage imposed on new entrants. So here, imagine that yesterday only two parties were competing. So now the preference state for this doesn't matter. Imagine yesterday there were two parties competing, 0 and minus 1, and that today all three parties are present. Now, the new entrant is party 1. We're going to assume that under plurality, the probability of winning is the share that this party gets as support minus some penalty beta, which we call the entry penalty. All right, so this is basically, you know, again, a reduced form way of capturing the barriers to entry to new parties under plurality that are only imposed, again, when three parties are competing in the election today and two were competing yesterday. And it goes, so basically this is sort of capturing the idea that's reflected in these findings by Anagel and Fujiwara, that past electoral history can act as a coordinating device for voters in current elections. So that's, again, it's very simple. We think about plurality as differing from proportional representation along these two dimensions. One is penalizing currently unpopular parties. The other is penalizing all new entrants, irrespective of their popularity. Right. Okay. So, you know, all these interest groups are risk neutral. They have sort of the preferences you'd expect. So supporting a party imposes a cost. And forming a party imposes a cost, the upper bar, which is higher than the cost of maintaining an existent party. Right, so this already generates an option value to having an established party, which is the difference in these, which is indexed by the difference in these two costs. But note that this is independent of the electoral system. These costs are paid by the parties in both cases. And there's a common discount factor for all interest groups. So what we're going to look at is Markov perfect equilibria. So the parties are going to condition, the interest groups are going to condition their party formation and maintenance decisions only on the payoff relevant state, which is the current preference state and yesterday's party structure, because yesterday's party structures affects whether or not entry costs are paid under plurality. All right. So what we do, the first thing we do with the model is we're going to look at a profile, so a candidate equilibrium profile, so the sigma PR, which has interest groups J are going to support a party, whether it's a new party or an existing party, if and only if there, if and only if the preference state does not favor their opponent, right? So now they just get a sense of, so the dynamics in this, under this profile, are going to be such that if the middle state is realized, all three parties are going to be active. And if one of the two extreme states is realized, there's going to be two parties active, the centrist party and the party that shares the label of the state. And I mean, one thing here also is that the party, the formation and maintenance decisions of the parties are independent of yesterday's party structures, right? They depend only on the realization today of the preference state. And so, you know, the first thing we do is we look at the region of the parameter space where this profile is in equilibrium. Let me skip that. Now, under plurality, we're going to look at a strategy profile in which first, these entry penalties are going to bite. So an interest group is going to form a new party if and only if it's in its own preference state. So it'll no longer form a party in the middle preference state. And interest groups are still going to support a party that's existing in the middle state and in its own state. So what's left to think about to complete these profiles is whether or not an interest group is going to support an existent party when it reaches the state of its ideological opponent, right? So there's two candidates. One is they do. So this sigma upper bar has maximal participation. So these parties always maintain parties that exist when they reach their opponent's preference state. Or sigma under bar, they don't. So they disband an existing party when they reach their opponent's preference state. So so the dynamics under these two profiles, so under sigma upper bar, at least after a certain amount of elections, you have three parties competing in all elections. Because once a party enters, it never leaves. Now, under sigma lower bar, you have a two-party equilibrium. So you always have two parties in all elections, although their identities change with the preference state, right? And under both these profiles, one thing that's interesting relative to the profile under proportional is that the participation decisions of the parties are persistent, right? So a party's participation decision does depend on whether or not it participated in the previous elections. Okay, now, so we have, basically, we have conditions under which these profiles are equilibria, and, you know, not surprisingly, so if the minority penalty is high enough, then minority parties will exit, so you'll have the two-party equilibrium. And if the minority penalty is low enough, then in that case, these minority parties will be maintained, and so you'll have the three-party equilibrium. Now, in terms of sort of comparative predictions, the equilibria under these equilibria under plurality exist in the region of the parameter space that contains the equilibrium under proportional, right? So you do get these two different behaviors under plurality that are possible when that equilibrium under proportional was in fact the unique equilibrium. And I mean, the interesting thing is that you can have, so the, under the three-party equilibrium under plurality, you could have there will be periods where you'll have more parties under plurality than under proportional, because you always have three parties under that sigma upper bar equilibrium, and you sometimes have two parties under the proportional equilibrium because there's entry and exit. So, but what you do have when you compare these equilibria is that you have more expected variation in the number of parties under the equilibrium under proportional than you do have under the equilibrium under plurality. Right? So under the equilibrium with the three-party equilibrium has no variability because there's always three parties, no party ever leaves. And there's also less variability in the two-party equilibrium because you never actually get to, in the two-party equilibrium, turns out that there's less exit because you actually never get to the three-party competition, which would then which under proportional you do, and then you get more exits registered when you leave. Okay, so I have very little time. I'll have to run through sort of the empirical section. So, you know, what we're looking for really is a correlation between a measure of electoral systems and a measure of party entry and exit. And so we had to, so there's some agreement of how to measure electoral systems. A measure of entry and exit, we had to find sort of a common cross-country electoral data set and try to come up with a way of measuring that. So in case I run out of time, so what we're looking for, we're going to regress, is our measure of party entry and exit on a bunch of different measures of electoral systems. And what we're looking for is a relationship that says that plurality systems lead to, or at least are associated with, less variation in the number of parties. In case I get lost, or I guess I wouldn't be here in the other case. But okay, so you know, measuring proportionality is hard. You know, I said there was agreement in sort of ways to do it, but I think there's also agreement that no way is particularly good. But you know, so there's a majoritarian dummy variable that registers a one. If the book by Person and Tabellini classified this as a majoritarian system, effective district magnitude looks at the average number of legislators elected in those districts that elect legislators, and so higher district magnitudes is more proportional. There's also a disproportionality indices that compare the seats and vote shares of parties, and on here we don't, our regressions don't do as well. But we think we have reasons for that. So I mean, you know, all of these measures are very correlated, right? So this is our sample of countries. The black dots are the majoritarian countries. They have low effective district magnitude and high disproportionality indices. Okay. So the tricky thing is how do we come up with a measure using only vote returns contained in this data set of parties entering and exit, of entry and exit by parties? And that's, you know, we have a way of doing it. We haven't come up with anything better. Anyhow, so this is what we do. So essentially the only thing we can use is a vote threshold. And so what we say is that a party is going to enter in a given district if it was below this vote threshold in the previous election and crosses this vote threshold in the current election. So what we're trying to do, you know, I was surprised that, look, say, the Canadian case of listing the number of parties competing in elections, you need to impose a vote threshold to rule out a bunch of sort of crazy parties that nobody's ever heard of. And so this is how we come up with it. And then crossing the threshold from above is what we define as, what we count of as an exit in a particular district. Now we need to aggregate this across districts to the national level, and we weigh this by the importance of the district in terms of how many deputies it then sends to the national chamber. You know, we're going to control for the number of districts in our regressions, because of course the number of districts is very much correlated with the electoral systems. So that's, you know, so the total number of entries, total number of exits, and then the total variation in the number of parties is just the sum of the two. Okay, so let me just put up a table. So, you know, on the left-hand side is the total variation in the number of parties. On the right-hand side is our measure of the electoral system. So the first two columns is the majoritarian dummy variable. The next two is effective district magnitude. Whoops, sorry, wrong table. And the last two are the disproportionality index. Now, in the first column is basically just the simple regression without controls. And the second column is basically all the controls that we found and we thought were good to include. So we can control for a decade, for time trends, regional controls, controlling for the number of districts, and controlling for the number of parties, because one thing that we were worried about is if there's more parties on average, we know there are more parties, and this was the previous table, there are more parties on average under proportional systems than under plurality systems, and so then you might just get a higher variation in the number of parties simply mechanically because you've got a higher average number. So that's why we do everything in logs to try to get away from some of these scaling effects, and we also add controls for the number of parties. And so definitely, at least with the first two measures of electoral systems, the results are quite strong. So majoritarian, and the results are also just as strong as if we split the left-hand side variable into either entry or exit. The result is just as strong if you look at these separately. Majoritarian countries are associated with lower variation in the number of parties, and the same under average district magnitude. So there's some reasons why the disproportionality index is not working quite well. It's a bit strange because the number of parties goes into computing this index, and there's a middle column where it does actually quite well before we control for the number of parties, which I didn't include. But these are maybe it's a more suspect way of measuring. And I'm done. So thank you very much. In case you're wondering, the 5% threshold doesn't matter. So these are coefficient estimates for thresholds between 0 and 10. And so it's, the precise picking of a threshold, given the fact that we don't think we can get away with measuring entry and exit through thresholds, the picking of the exact threshold doesn't matter. But thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I love the idea of this conference. I'm a big fan. And I appreciate the honor of discussing a paper. So this is a paper by Jean-Guillaume and Vikram on a particular take on this very old notion of the relationship between electoral system and party structures. So the starting point of this idea, which I very much like, is the notion that on the one hand, empirically, there is a lot of unexplained variation, time series variation in party structure, which standard theories of Duverger law, which are typically static in nature, cannot account for. On the other hand, these theories are very much, and it's a reasonable starting point, focused on voters' incentives. Voters have different incentives to coordinate, and that might be a driver of differences in vote shares that different parties obtain under different systems. And so, to quote Meyerson in front of Meyerson, Duverger law can be interpreted as a statement about the relative barriers to entry under different electoral systems. So we learn enough about this voter level in incentives to make statements, macro statements, about how that translates into the incentive from the perspective of party leadership. To think of this as barriers to entry, and it's sort of reasonable thinking of how market dynamics work, of what we know about market dynamics, to at least start thinking about the fact that these barriers to entry might affect long-term decision by party elites. And so what Vikram and Jean-Guillaume do is essentially take this as a starting point and develop a model of it. There's various choices that one can make, and I think that they start with what most of us would start with. So start with a world where there's a fixed set of policy positions. There are activists or elites that essentially control the choice of whether or not a certain position will be represented, will be championed by a party. And they have the control over whether the party will compete in an election. Running a party is costly, and therefore this core group of activists, this elite, has to have electoral incentives to run to keep a party running. how these incentive, what drives these incentives? Well, there is some sort of unobserved and exogenous change in voter states, tastes for different policy options, which will affect the current electoral appeal of a party, and this thing is evolving over time. And very much in the spirit of the quote that I had, differences across electoral systems are captured by reduced form assumptions, which are supposed to capture different incentives that voters have and sort of mechanic effects of how votes translates into seats under different systems. So there's essentially two strategic actors. There's three policy positions, but effectively two party leaders. There is a third option, which is always there. There is a left and a right elite, which decides whether or not the left and the right-wing party will compete in an election. Stochastic exogenous support in the electorate for different policy positions. Sometimes voters prefer the centrist position. Sometimes voters have a leftist swing. Sometimes they have a rightist swing. The choice of whether or not a party will be running depends on this elite choice. And under proportional representation is essentially a situation where the payoff of this party elite will enjoy is proportional to the vote share that they will obtain in the election. That's it. Under plurality, instead, the payoff also depends on party structures. And the authors, and this is, I think, where the interesting modeling choice is, where the action is in terms of what to do, lies. Choose to make two assumptions, to essentially introduce two penalties. The first is a minority penalty, which says if the swing happens to favor, say, a leftist policy position, a rightist party will receive a payoff that's less than proportional to its natural support, conditional on the other party being there. And this is a reduced form way of capturing what we call the bandwagon effect and the mechanical effect. The fact that the formula that translates votes into seats is steeper under plurality rule than under proportional representation. The other thing that they do is to introduce this entry penalty, which captures the potential existence of dynamic incentives to coordinate for voters. If yesterday we coordinated around one party, it's more likely that today we keep doing that. Voters face a coordination problem, and why not? The past is a reasonable way to drive our choice. So if the leftist party was present in the previous election and is still present, and on the other hand, we were not running in the previous period, we didn't have a party, then we have this penalty associated with entering. The payoff that we enjoy is going to be less than proportional to the natural basin of votes that we would get, say, under proportional representation. So essentially what happens under proportional rule, and they are able to prove that this is the unique mark of perfect equilibrium, is that if unless the voter dislikes you, you're gonna enter the election, you're gonna be present. If the partisan swing is against you, you're gonna stay out. And that's it. Things are more complicated under plurality rule. The authors are able to characterize a reasonable class of mark of perfect equilibria, where if you are favored by the partisan swing, of course you're going to be in. But when that is not the case, so either the voter is favoring the centrist option or is favoring the option on the other side of the spectrum, then your choice of being in is also driven by past configuration of the party system. In particular, if voter is neutral or dislikes you, and only your opponent was in before, so you did not have a party in the previous period, then you have to remain out. However, if voter is against you and you were running in the previous period, then your choice of whether or not you're going to remain in the election depends on the size of the minority penalty. And there are some equilibria where you stay in, and there are some where you stay out, and some equilibria where you actually choose to enter. First order implication, that there is less volatility in party structure under plurality. But the cross-sectional implication of this of the comparison between these equilibria does not yield a unique prediction. The plurality system does not necessarily generate a two-party system. It can happen, but also not. Okay? So why do I think that this is interesting? For two reasons that I think could be highlighted more, in the especially in the introduction. The first is that this paper is able to identify in a nice sense in which, under plurality, the party system should be less responsive to changes over time in voter states, even without the emergence of new issues. So in this model, there are actually no new issues. The strength of the results is that this is driven by the dynamic consideration of someone controlling known policy options. So there is a fixed set of policy positions, and even without new issues, you have this limited responsiveness. The second reason why I find this interesting is that it's not that the static models are incompatible with non-Duvergerian outcomes, but in various sense, these non-Duvergerian equilibrium outcomes are more fragile. They don't survive refinements. They typically require a lot of subtle coordination among voters, while here there is a clear dynamic force that underlies the non-necessity of Duvergerian outcomes. So I'm going to spend the last 5 minutes providing a few observations about modeling, but I must stress that I really like the motivation of this paper. I learned a lot, and I kept thinking about this while approaching this conference. So the first is about is purely rhetorical. It's about labeling. So typically, when I'm asked, when I start thinking about Duverger law, I take the famous Riker example about different constituencies in the UK, where there is a problem of coordination between liberal and Labour vis-a-vis conservative options. This seems to be more natural given that you are trying to model the bandwagon effect. The minority penalty goes to the advantage of the other party. So in this model, it's as if, because of the minority penalty, some voters choose to vote for the, say, right-wing party instead of the left-wing party, while they naturally like a left-wing option. My sense, and you actually talk about it in a footnote, is that the structure of the model will be completely unchanged. And I want to hear about that. But if that is the case, I think it makes sense to make this choice, because this is how I think many people think. The second thing, which is a little bit more substantive, is that in order to draw this comparison between PR and plurality, you make two changes, not one. You introduce these two penalties, and I think that the entry penalty has a much longer intellectual history. The micro foundation behind the entry penalty, sorry, the minority penalty, has a much richer history. This is the bandwagon effect. When I read it, it took me 1 second, and I was like, of course, it makes complete sense. For the entry penalty, I had to think about it, and it's motivated using the work by Thomas and. It's not that I don't believe it, but I think it's less rooted in the history, in the intellectual history of this thing. So what I'm wondering is, what happens in this cell? So what if you have only the minority penalty. Even if I was completely persuaded that the entry penalty and the minority penalty make both equally sense from a theoretical standpoint, I still want to know what drives what. And I have a conjecture. I thought about it. I didn't solve it. I'm a very lazy discussant. And I don't like to solve for Markov perfect equilibria. But there is a sense in which you might actually get an equilibrium that is able to explain both the cross-sectional and the dynamic empirical results that you later document in the very same paper. So I just encourage you to explore this direction. Maybe you did, and if so, please tell me what happens. Couple of things about measurement and empirics. I think this is a much broader point, the first, and it applies to many other papers. Besides these two penalties, the defining feature of this paper is that it takes a stance as to what is the source of these differences in party structure, and your model points at an explanation that's based on elite behavior, not only on voter behavior. Yet the empirical exercise is based on comparing cast votes. And I had a hard time sort of thinking about whether the evidence that you propose is allows us to distinguish between explanations that are purely driven by voter behavior and explanations that are also based on elite on a strategic choice by party elites. When you defend your choice of linear weighting, which I don't disagree in principle, it got me to think that it seems to stack the empirical results in the direction of your model. And I worked out a simple example which has about 33% chance of being wrong, where it seems like the linear weighting somewhat understates the variability in party structure under plurality, which is what you're trying to argue for. Finally, and I'm done. If I think of the more plausible of the two Markov perfect equilibria that you describe under plurality, it seems like it has much richer predictions than the one that you document, because essentially the Markov perfect equilibrium make statements about when we should expect more entries and more exits as a function of the type of partisan swing. When voters has a swing that favors the centrist party, there should be more entry under PR. So I wonder if you can do that, something with that too. Thank you very much.
I have two comments related to Carlos. One on this beta. So, like, I mean, I'm not really convinced by the Thomas and Santos example, because the example you're taking to motivate the assumption comes when actually the party was running to begin with, right? It was a third party. And here, the guy, you're taking the example where there's no third party, they just come into play. And I was thinking that, given your answer to Carlos, maybe a way to rationalize this is that instead of electoral cost, material cost of running against a party. I believe much more that, you know, like sort of organizing and coordinating the new electorate is much more costly than just barely running if you're already into play. But that doesn't necessarily have to come from the electoral side of the vote. That way you get, I mean, because you can also be the complete opposite, that beta is actually negative because you're the newcomer and therefore everybody coordinates on you, and then that really hurts you in terms of given the explanation you gave to Carlo. But if it comes from the material side, it's just a lot harder to organize a new party as opposed to just being there. Then I think it's much more believable in terms of the assumption, because it seems like you really need it.
Yeah, because the theorist in me says, however you want to think about the beta, the alpha, the CF, or the CLO, it's fine with me.
Sure. if you want to appeal to the comparativist, you know, that's going to be a much more swallowable assumption.
Miss out on the, I think, you know, there's a big literature on looking at the impacts on smaller parties of vote coordination, and it's, you know, because these Cs, I talk about them as costs, but they're whatever these parties care about, so it's influence and I guess, to really stress this, I agree these material costs are there. Oh, and also we have, I mean, just have you don't have data on what the relative, what the relative scale of the material costs versus the actual power from the parliament is.
Let's do Ethan and then Scott.
Can you say, Carlo raises this in his comments, can you say a word about this, not the beta, but the alpha? It also struck me when you put up the slide, there's something feels unnatural about, we think about this thing as the coordination costs, right? That the voters are failing to, or what, when you lose the votes because of the voter coordination, they're not coordinating on giving those votes to the nearest ideological party. And
yeah.
Carlos suggested maybe this doesn't, but I...
Yeah, so I forgot how we worded the footnote, so
they're almost the same.
Yes, yeah, they're almost the same. So you could basically relabel it. You know, the only thing that really matters, that I labeled one as 0, minus 1, and 1 doesn't necessarily matter as much as how they're, what happens if they decide not to compete, depending on who else is competing. And we can relabel almost everything to make it as though there were, say, two parties on the left and a single right-wing party, and the game is between the two parties on the left that would then hurt one another. There's just one little
vote shares also.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. It's really almost the same. There's one little part where you can't exactly reformulate it, but we could then sort of rewrite the model and sort of, change the equilibrium characterizations minimally, but that's not essential. But it's true that it, what's posted sounds like a reasonable. It sounds like the more natural way to think about the problem.
I can see why you started from what had to be a symmetric structure, and that is a natural starting point. I mean, I think many people think of this UK constituency.
Yeah. Well.